In the last lecture, we were talking about the concept of mean beam length. For the calculation of transmittance in enclosures or in furnaces, and let us now elaborate a little bit more on this concept. To do that, we first have to look at a simple geometry. So, let us look at a hemispheric enclosure, and there is a gas in this enclosure along with the surface, and this entire gas is emitting to its base. So, from the concept we discussed in the last lecture, Aj, F, Aj, Tak, that is the radiation from all the gas elements to the base here, you can do the integration over whole of Aj, and the expression is like this. And cos theta j is 1 because the rays leaving the surface j are always normal to the surface. Now, because it is a spherical system, the integration is always very simple in these calculations. So, you will get all these are independent of theta k. So, they come out, and you can express dAj in terms of theta k. So, finally, you have a result which can be integrated very easily, and you get Aj F dAj dAk into the transmittance, which is what we want, as dAk exponential e to the power minus a lambda r. And using reciprocity, it is always valid. Aj F Aj dAk is dAk F dAk Aj, and knowing that all the radiant leaving dAk has to reach j, we conclude that the mean transmittance is nothing but e to the minus a lambda r. So, what we see is that when a hemispheric enclosure is radiating to its base, center of the base, then the expression for transmittance is very simple, is nothing but e to the power of minus a lambda r. Now, for other geometries, life is a lot more complicated, because in other geometries, the simple equations which we had here, because theta j is 0 and elements are simple, is not there. Let me give an example of slightly more complicated situation. Suppose we want to calculate the radiation from the top of the cylinder to its base. We can write down the expressions, and there you see that Aj F dAj dAk into tau bar, which is what we want. We can return in terms of dAk and all these quantities. Now, this integral can be calculated, but only numerically. So, the relation between tau bar, the mean transmittance of all the rays, and the geometry of the problem, that is the radius of the cylinder horizontal, is not very simple. It is pretty complicated. You can calculate that on the computer, but for practical engineering use, this is a little messy. So, it would be nice to express this as an equivalent hemispherical enclosure. So, we look at all real life geometries that we encounter, cylindrical, parallel plates, cuboid or other things, and we do the integration numerically, but finally, we would like to provide an expression which is easy to use. So, idea is convert the numerical integration of these equations to an equivalent length, that is, make this equivalent to this kind of system. So, that equivalent length is called the mean beam length. So, mean beam length is nothing but the length scale, which when used in this formula, tau equal to e to the power minus ar, will give you the same transmitter as the actual expression, which is much more complicated. So, you are replacing the real geometry with an equivalent hemispherical geometry. So, mean beam length is radius of that fictitious hemispherical enclosure, which will give you the same transmittance as a real geometry which you are dealing with, whether it is cylindrical or rectangular or something else. You want to express this in terms of, this is of course an approximation. So, there is bound to be some error in these approximations. Now, one example of this is given in this case. Now, we have two parallel plates and you want to know the gas which is emitting from all the gas layers here emitting to this base here. What is the mean beam length? To do that, the exact expression for two parallel plates can be shown to be 1 minus 2 E 3 into A D, which is the exponential integral function which we had encountered earlier. And here it is compared with a simple expression 1 minus e to the minus 1 point A D, where 1 point A D is the mean beam length. And you see that this ratio is somewhere between 92% to 105% of the exact value. So, if you are happy with an error of the order of 5%, then you can replace the complicated expression in terms of exponential integral function in terms of a simple function in terms of exponential. So, what this figure shows is mean beam length concept is quite useful over a range of optical depths 0.04 to 8. It is within 5% of the exact result you can get by numerical integration. So, here is a table which gives you the characteristic dimensions of various geometries that we encounter in furnaces. The first one, of course, hemisphere radiating base is what we have done. Sphere radiating to surface, circular cylinder radiating center of the base, then radiating to the convex bonding surface, and various examples here, and infinite slab. In all these cases, they have given you the value of the mean beam length in the limit of optical depth being very small, one value. And for finite optical depth, they are not same because there is some variation. And the ratio of the finite optical depth mean beam length to the optically thin beam length. And the good news is that in most cases, except one here, it is within 10% of the optically thin result. So, if you have no access to these detailed calculations and you want estimate the mean beam length, then if you use the mean beam length for the optically thin limit, you would not have more than 10% error at most, except this one case which is a little larger, 20%. So, if there is a situation in which a encountered geometry is not covered by this table and you would like to estimate the mean beam length, then you are first use this mean beam length expression for the thin limit, and that we will derive now. So, what is the mean beam length in the optically thin limit? So, the idea is we have an arbitrary shape, maybe anything, radiating to some boundary, and you want to calculate the mean beam length in the optically thin limit. Okay. And so total radiation that is emitted to the from the volume to the base is the emissivity of the volume. This is your ds here, and in terms of black body intensity into d a into d omega, the general expression. Now, because you are talking about optically thin limit, this becomes A lambda ds, I prime lambda b dA d omega. We will assume that approximately dA into ds is equal to the volume of the gas element. It is not a bad approximation. And so you will have, and everything is independent of angle here. So this will integrate to 4 pi. Finally, you will get an expression which is 4 pi I prime lambda b A lambda dv, A lambda dv. Okay, integrate all, we'll do also volume integration. So, what you are saying is, if you have this arbitrary shaped object, the volume V and an area surface to which it is emitting area is A, then the radiation emitted to the base of that is this much. Okay. Now, this is the exact expression obtained with this. Now, this we want compared to equivalent hemisphere. The equivalent hemisphere will have radiation to the base based on this length LE, this is the equivalent length, and is LE 0 because you are doing in the, going to do it now in the optical thin limit, into E lambda B into A. Okay. So, this will come out as A lambda LEO E lambda B into A for A lambda LEO much less than 1. This is our assumption. So, we compare this result with the previous result, that is A lambda LEO E lambda B into A is equal to 4 A lambda E lambda B into V. So, this will cancel out. So, I am sorry, this is already there. A lambda actually. So, the optically thin mean blend then comes out as 4 V by A. So, that is the important derivation. So, in the optically thin limit, we can derive a general expression LEO as being equal to 4 V by A. This is a very useful result because any geometry that you take, once you know its volume and the area to which it is emitting, then the mean beam length is 4 V by A. So, this is useful for any arbitrary shaped object. Now, we saw that LE by LEO is typically in the range from 0.8 to anywhere between 0.8 to 1. So, if you are willing to accept that kind of error. So, for example, the mean value is around 0.9. So, there are people who use LE as like Hotler has done, we use that value 3.6 by V because he assumed that LE is approximately equal to 0.9 times LEO. So, some people use 3.5, some use 3.6, depends on the particular application and the situation. So, this is a commonly use method to estimate the emissivity and transmissivity of gas of arbitrary volume and shape for which you do not have ready made integration available. And it is very useful in the design of furnaces and estimate of ready heat combustion chambers. So, this is a typical engineering treatment of the problem. We are treating the entire gas tube isothermal, which is not always a good approximation, but we do that in order to be able to estimate fluxes in a simple way. So, after we assume the furnace to be isothermal, we need to make an estimate of the emissivity and transmissivity of the gas in the furnace. For that, we had a general expression which we had discussed in the last lecture, and that the expression can be integrated for certain standard geometries like cylinders, spheres and parallel plates and so on. But for other cases, the integration can become quite tedious. So, for such cases, the simple expression for the thin limit and approximation for any other optical depth is utilized in practice. Now, remember, these are basically approaches which are meant for design analysis, not for accurate estimate of fluxes. And these are useful because at the design stage, you need to have a rough idea about the fluxes that will be encountered in that application. And at that stage in design, we are not looking for accurate data, it is merely the initial estimate. So, these kind of methods work quite well. But later on, once the furnace is designed and you want an accurate estimate of fluxes in that furnace to evaluate its performance, you may want to do it in a more accurate way, for which you have to use standard radiation codes, and many of the codes these days are Monte Carlo codes. And so, you will use these codes, which will handle all the complexities related to the fact that the gases are non-gray and maybe non-isotropic surfaces, all that can be handled. But that kind of elaborate use of software is warranted if and only if you need high accuracy. At the design stage, normally one is quite happy to get an estimate within 10% of the actual, because there are going to be various adjustments at the design stage. But once the furnace is constructed and you want to estimate its performance, then you need more accurate analysis, and for that standard more complex radiant packages are used. So, in engineering, we adopt both an approximate method as well as the exact method. And approximate normally is for the as a design stage, and exact at the performance stage, because when you are judging the performance of an engineering device, you are competing with other manufacturers. So, you need to provide fairly accurate estimate of the performance of your device. So, you may not be satisfied with the 10 to 20% accuracy, you may want more like 1% accuracy, for which you will use standard complex radiation codes to estimate that. So, with that we conclude our discussion on radiative transfer for engineering application in furnaces. We may later on take up some examples to illustrate this further, but now we go on to a new topic, radiation, called radiation pyrometry. Now, one of the important applications of radiation is to sense temperature in furnaces remotely. In most cases, in engineering practice, temperatures are measured using thermometers, thermocouples or other devices which contact the surface whose temperature you want to measure. But there are situations, especially high temperature conditions, wherein it is not possible to actually touch the surface. So, you would like to measure temperature remotely. That is, you measure the radiation emitted by surface, and using that you want to infer what is the temperature of that surface. So, this is getting quite common now, and infrared thermometers are available for many applications where you will estimate the temperature of any hot object by merely directing a thermometer towards it, measuring the radiation coming in, and from there inferring the. So, in that context, there are various quantities defined, and some of them are called radiative temperature or brightness temperature or color temperature. So, in this lecture, we will elaborate that so that it can be used in practice. The simplest, when you measure a quantity of radiant coming from a surface, what you are measuring is emissive surface and of course the black body emission. This is what is measured by you. And if you equate it to a black body, then this temperature is an effective temperature and this is called the radiative temperature. So, whatever flux that is coming from that source, you assume it is a black body. So, write it equal to sigma d to the power of 4 and estimate Tr. But Tr will not be equal to Ts unless epsilon s is 1. So, the emissivity of surface whose temperature you are measuring is unity, then it is very simple. And you can estimate by saying the radiative temperature equal to actual temperature. Now, this is quite true for a water body. A typical water body like a lake or ocean has emissivity very close to 1. And so, you can assume it to be equal to 1 and this method will work quite well. But you would like to know what is the error in measurement. In any time you make any measurement, you want to know what is the error. So, in this case, error is nothing but the actual temperature of the object minus what you are measuring, the radiative temperature by the actual temperature. And from that equation, you can see it is equal to 1 minus 4th root of epsilon. Okay. So, let us see what this error amounts to. Suppose emissivity of the surface is somewhat low, let us say 0.656 for convenience. You substitute that here, you will find it is 0.9. So, you can see that error in temperature is 10% if the emissivity is as low as 0.656. But many surfaces that we deal with have emissivities close to 0.8, 0.9, 0.95 and so on. For all those cases, the errors will be much lower. So, if you are satisfied with measuring temperature with accuracies in the range of 5 to 10%, then measuring the radiative temperature and assuming the surface black body should work quite well for you. But if you are not happy, because remember 10% accuracy may be adequate in some cases, but there are situations where if you are measuring the temperature of a surface which is at, let us say, 18 degrees Kelvin and the error is 10%, that is 80 degrees Kelvin, and that may not be adequate for certain applications. So, if you want higher accuracy, then you have to do something else. Either you have to know the emissivity of the surface, that is always difficult, as we saw earlier, that emissivity of any, especially metallic surface at high temperature depends on the level of oxidation, which can change a lot in time. So, it is difficult to presume that you will know the emissivity of the surface whose temperature you are trying to measure, that you will know it in advance. So, if the emissivity surface is unknown and is not high, then you have to use some other tactics. Now, the method we discussed so far is based on measurement of total radiation surface. Now, we can go a little different, we can measure spectral radiation. So, use a radiometer with a filter to measure the radiation emitted to surface at a particular wavelength. Okay. So, that is epsilon lambda E lambda B. and you equate that to a certain temperature, and this quantity is called brightness temperature. So, brightness temperature by definition is the temperature of an object, assuming that all the radiation emitted by object is from a black body. So, it is a equivalent black body temperature, which gives the same flux as what you are measuring. And once more, if the epsilon lambda, the emissivity of the surface at that wavelength, it is quite close to 1, then your accuracy is not too bad. For example, we know the black body emissivity can be written as a constant C 1 by lambda to the power of phi e to the power of C 2 by lambda T s minus 1, and you are equating this to the brightness temperature of the object, which is assuming it is a black body. This is T B, I am sorry, this T B. Okay. So, we want to again estimate what is the error. So, if you want, you can rewrite this as follows. We can rewrite C 2 of lambda T s is equal to log of 1 plus epsilon lambda into e to the power of C 2 by lambda dB minus 1. If emissivity is 1, of course, T s equals T b. That is by definition. Now, the question is, what is the error in assuming T b equals T s when emissivity is not equal to 1? Now, to do that, I'll take a simple case. Now, there are many applications where this quantity will be much greater than 1. Most applications that we deal with in engineering, this is valid. So, in that case, T s becomes approximately T b by lambda T b by C 2 log epsilon lambda plus 1. So, if epsilon is 1, of course, this term goes 0, you are back to this design. Now, you can see that these two are very close to each other. If this quantity is much, much less than 1, then they are very close. For example, if this is 0.01, then you are making only an error of 1%. If it is 0.05, maybe errors of 5%. So, I want to highlight the fact that this quantity typically is around 0.1. So, even if epsilon was not 1, let us say was 0.6 or something, this quantity will be quite small. And so, that is the great merit of this concept of brightness temperature, and has been used widely in satellite application. In satellite, from the space, you are measuring the, let us say, temperature of the ocean, and you are measuring not totally, but in a certain region, certain wavelength range where the atmosphere is transparent. So, you are inferring the brightness temperature, and since the emissivity of the ocean is quite close to 1, this quantity is very small. So, your estimate of the surface temperature can be quite accurate. Today, satellite derived estimates of sea surface temperature can be as accurate as 0.5 degree centigrade accuracy. The inaccuracies that come in there is nothing to do with this approach which is suggested. It is more due to absorption by water vapor in the atmosphere and other problem with clouds and so on. But otherwise, measurement of brightness temperature from space has been a very useful technique to estimate the surface temperature of both land and ocean from satellite. In the case of land, the situation is a little more complicated. In the case of ocean, emissivity is close to 1. So, this is very accurate. But in the case of land, desert regions can have emissivity as low as 0.7. So, inaccuracies can creep up in such a situation. So, you can see that the measurement of brightness temperature will give you a more accurate estimate than the measurement of total radiation that we saw in the definition of radiative temperature. That is because in the case of radiative temperature, the error went as 1 minus 4th root of epsilon. Here, the error depends on logarithm of epsilon, which reduces its power. Further, there is a quantity in the front, which makes it a very, very low estimate of the quantity, and this quantity is already 0.1. So, your emissivity can be quite low. Even if emissivity is around 0.6 or 0.5, we saw the errors can be of the order 10%. Here, it will be much lower because the quantity multiplying in front is much lower than unity. Now, suppose you encounter a situation wherein emissivity is quite low and the accuracy that you can obtain by measuring the brightness temperature is not good enough, then one can adopt a more elaborate method, and this method uses 2 wavelengths. Okay. So, the idea of using 2 wavelengths is the hope that for a given surface, emissivity may vary a lot and it may be quite low, but if you choose 2 adjacent wavelengths nearby, the assumption is epsilon lambda does not vary much. If you take a small change difference in lambda, maybe 0.1 micron or 0.2 micron, the emissivity is not going to stay a lot. So, if that happens, and that is often the case for most surfaces, even though emissivity may not be equal to 1, the variation emissivity lambda around a certain region may not be large. And this idea is exploited by looking at the ratio of the emission at 1 wavelength to an adjacent wavelength. And comparing with the ratio of the black bodies at those 2 wavelengths. So, this is called a color temperature. A color temperature of an object is that temperature at which the ratio of the emissive power at the 2 wavelengths is same as that of black body at the temperature T c. So, at the temperature Tc, the ratio of emission from black body at these two wavelengths is equivalent to that in the actual object. Now, you might wonder how this is different from brightness temperature. In the brightness temperature, you are equating the actual radiation received at a given wavelength to that of a black body and asking what the black body temperature is. In the case of color temperature, you are not saying that the emission from that body is equivalent to black body. You are looking at the ratio of the two emissions. So, which is a more complicated assumption. And again, if you assume that C2 by lambda Ts is much greater than 1, which is again normally the case, then you can show that the difference between color temperature and the actual temperature surface is approximately equal to C2 1 by lambda 2 minus 1 by lambda 1 log epsilon lambda 1 by epsilon lambda 2. So, let me write it a little differently so there is no confusion. So, epsilon lambda at lambda equals lambda 1 to epsilon lambda at lambda equals lambda 2. Okay. Now, notice that the difference between the color temperature and the surface temperature depends not on the emissivity of the surface, but on the ratio of emissivity. So, what we find is that the surface can have quite low emissivity, can be 0.1 or 0.2, as long as that emissivity does not vary a lot between the two wavelengths you are choosing, then this quantity will be quite close to 1 and log 1 is 0. So, your color temperature will be very close to the actual temperature. So, the accuracy of measurement now is not depending on the value of emissivity, but in assuring that emissivity does not vary very, very much with wavelength. But of course, there is a challenge here. You would like the adjacent wavelength to be quite close to the one of the wavelengths you have chosen, but they cannot be too close, note that this quantity will go to 0. So, this demands that the two wavelengths should not be too close. But at the same time, it cannot be too far. If it is too far, this quantity will go up. So, there is a trade off in this choice of wavelengths. We chose wavelengths too close to each other, this quantity will go to 1, but this quantity will go to 0. So, you will get 0 by 0, so we do not know. But if you choose a little far away, then this quantity may be departing from 1, may not depart much, but this quantity will increase. So, error will be kept down. So, this is the most accurate method of measuring temperature from sources by remote method. So, the remote technique, you do not have to touch the surface. That is why it is so popular in satellite applications. So, in satellite application, either the concept of brightness temperature, that is measurement at one wavelength, is used, or more commonly they choose two adjacent wavelengths and choose the wavelength such that the difference between the color temperature and surface temperature is very, very small. And there is a design freedom here in choosing the two wavelengths. And so, in most cases, you will be able to choose a wavelength sufficiently far apart so that this term is not going to 0, but in that wavelength range, emissivity is not varying that much with wavelength, although it may be low. So, this may be more accurate, but you can imagine that it is also a more elaborate technique. So, the instrumentation is more expensive because you are not just comparing the emission from a surface, you are comparing the ratio of the emission from the surface at two different wavelengths with the same ratio for a black body. So, the accuracy demanded for the measurement is little more demanding here because you are talking about ratios. And, but still you can see this method is definitely superior to either the radiative temperature approach or the Brennus temperature approach, because you can measure the temperature of surfaces with very low emissivity as long as the emissivity is not a strong function of wavelength. As long as you are in this kind of domain, when emissivity is varying very slowly with wavelength, you can easily choose two adjacent wavelength, which will make this ratio close to 1 and make this ratio sufficiently large that the error that is introduced is kept to a very small value. And there is a lot of design freedom because you have the freedom to choose the two wavelength such that the error is below a certain value. So, what you have seen is that there are three ways of measuring temperature remotely by sensing the emission from the surface. The simplest approach is the total radiation parameter, which measures the total radiation from the surface. Assume it is a black body, estimates its radiative temperature, and this method can give accuracy of the order 10%, which is adequate for certain application. If one is not satisfied with that, one can go to measurement at a given wavelength, and that method is called the Brennus temperature technique, and is used widely in certain metrology. And therein, you are measuring only temperature at one wavelength, and although emissivity may be low, we saw that the quantity multiplying this emissivity term is quite small, and then we are dealing with log of the emissivity, which is a small quantity. And so, the total error that is introduced because emissivity is not equal to 1 can be quite low. But if one is not satisfied with this also, one can ultimately go to the most elaborate method, which involves comparing the fluxes from a given surface at two different wavelengths, adjacent wavelength. And this method will work very well even for low emissivity surfaces, because what the method demands is only that the emissivity can be low, but will not change rapidly with wavelength. So, we have seen various techniques of measuring temperature remotely. This is also occasion to briefly mention what are the sensors used in radiation measurements for this kind of application. Now, the sensor that you use depends on your application. So, I will typically talk about the method, talk about the wavelength range where you can use the method, its sensitivity, so how it depends on temperature changes, linearity and selectivity. For example, look at calorimetric method. It is one of the most accurate. We merely absorb that radiation coming from a surface, measure the temperature rise using calorimetry, and you can use all wavelength ranges. You can measure temperature at any wavelength, but sensitivity is somewhat low because ultimately your accuracy sensitivity depends upon your ability to measure temperature change in response to the radiant coming in, and so sensitivity can be quite low. But it is very linear, which you can appreciate because the incoming radiation and the temperature change are linear related. So, this method is pretty good linear. It is no selectivity in wavelength, but that can be overcome by putting a filter. So, we want to measure only radiation in a certain wavelength range, then you can put a filter to block out those wavelength ranges, then this method is still quite good. So, this is the oldest method and still used as primary standard. The second method is photoelectric, method in which you convert the absorption of incoming photons to electrical signal, and this operates well in the low wavelength up to 40 micron. Beyond 40 micron, the frequency is very low. So, your photon may not be able to knock an electron out or do something substantial. So, you might have difficulty in dealing with wavelengths below 40 micron. This is a very sensitive method. That means there is a small change in your incoming radiation gives a large signal. Its linearity is quite good, but not as good as the calibrating method. Calibrating method is the best for this thing, and it is quite selective because in the photoelectric method you are looking at a photon absorbed by surface, knocking an electron out of the ground state and taking it higher. So, it will respond only to certain wavelength range. The last method is photoelectric. And photographic. This is again an old method, but it is related only to the high wavelength, low wavelength region near visible. So, it works only from 0 to 1.2 micron range. It is very highly sensitive, not linear, and selectivity is quite high. Now, this method is used, for example, to detect fires from space. It is important for many applications to look at how much of the surface of the earth anytime is undergoing damage due to fire, and you would like to measure from satellite the amount of area around the world which is influenced by fire. Now, the amazing part is a satellite in space at a height of 1000 to even higher heights is able to detect very weak signal coming from forest fires. Now, this is possible because of special instrumentation which enables one to amplify the signal millions of times. So, the signals are amplified millions of times, then you get a very, very strong signal. And the technique which enables us to multiply is called photomultiplier. So, these are used to convert the weak signal coming in the visible region from forest fires to a million times, and then one can measure sources with very low intensity. And based on this, satellites have mapped the movement of forest fires across the world. And they have shown that in the continent of Africa, there are large fires extending thousands of kilometers across, and they move north-south following the season, because most forest fires set are instigated during the dry season. And so, they can be tracked from satellite, and that was possible because of photomultipliers being available, which increase the signal strength almost more than a million times to give a very accurate estimate of the surface condition. Now, this is achieved in these photomultipliers, in which essentially you have a photon knocking electron out of the bound region. And once the electron is free, they can be accelerated by a suitable accelerating device. And the total gain that you achieve in a photomultiplier depends upon the gain depends on how much multiplication can achieve and the number of such devices. Since this goes as m to the power of n, you can reach fairly large values, because if in one device the gain is of the order of 4 or 5, and there are 25 such devices one after another, then your gain will be 5 to the power of 25, can be very large. And so, these have been routinely used to detect very weak signals from the surface. The other application of radiation measurement other than satellite is to measure the temperature during manufacturing process. Now, in such occasions like the steel industry and other industries, when a billet or some other object is moving continuously, it is difficult to measure the temperatures of the object by physically connecting it to a thermocouple or a thermometer. So, for such application, remote sensing is desirable. And that is well provided by radiation heat transfer. Now, the technique we discussed about reaching a high amplification factor of the order of a million can only occur in those devices where the electron is knocked into the conduction band of the substance, and then it is allowed to accelerate by providing a voltage gradient. So, that is why these techniques are normally available only for visible, because the frequency of visible rays is high, so it can actually knock out electron to the conducting state, and wherein it can easily be accelerated. If you had a photon in the, let us say, far infrared, it may not have adequate energy to knock electron into the conduction band. So this technique of using photomultiplier and detecting forest fires is an example of use of visible radiation in a photomultiplier and reaching very high level of detection. Now, this may not be possible for infrared or microwave wavelengths. It is only the special feature of visible wavelengths. So, today we saw essentially discussion on engineering treatment of furnaces as well as a few practical measurement techniques based on radiation heat transfer. So, this highlights the some of the practical application. Now, we will go back to a more accurate treatment of radiation heat transfer and finally, take up the more difficult problem of scattering.